So basically, we want to prove in details that the measure of an opening of a closed interval AB is actually equal to the length of AB. So of course, the closed interval AB is measurable. So we have measure of AB equal to the length of AB. So basically, what we just need to prove here is that we need to prove that the outer measure of this interval is actually equal to the length. And what is the length? B minus A. So basically, this is what we are gonna do. First, we need to prove that the outer measure is less than, is less or equal to, and we also need to prove that the same outer measure of the closed interval AB is greater than or equal to this as well. So this is very simple, it's trivial, but let's see how we are going to go about it. And this one, that is where the work is. So let's get started. So first, you will first notice that the closed interval AB is actually fully contained in this open interval. The closed interval AB is actually fully contained in this interval A minus epsilon, B plus epsilon, where epsilon is greater than zero, where epsilon is any positive number. So by monotonicity of the outer measure, what do we have? We have closed interval AB to be less or equal to, of course, we have discussed before in the previous video, in my previous video, that the outer measure of an open interval is actually equal to the length. So this is basically B minus A plus 2 epsilon. So this is not depending on epsilon. So as epsilon goes to zero, obviously this is a positive number. So this will obviously be, the outer measure of AB will be less or equal to B minus A. So since epsilon is arbitrary, we can easily have this. So this is the first part. So we are done with this part. So for the second part, remember, we are left to prove now that the outer measure of the closed interval AB is greater than or equal to B minus A. That is the next thing. So basically, this is what we will do. Now, I need to recall a theorem with you first. It's called the Engorian's theorem. And what does the Engorian's theorem say? The Engorian's theorem says that every closed and bounded interval, every closed and bounded interval is compact. So basically, what is the meaning of compact? Compact just means that whenever you have it, when a set is covered by, you know, some covers, you can find a finite subcover. Don't worry, by the time I write them out, you will understand what I'm saying perfectly. But then, the first thing we need to do is, let me call the closed interval J so that I don't have to keep repeating, you know, closed interval AB. So this is what I will do. By definition of the outer measure, what is the definition of the outer measure? By definition, you know, the outer measure is equal to the infimum of summation of what? K starting from 1 to infinity of the length of IK, such that what? J is fully contained in the union in the union of IK, where IK are sequence of open intervals. So this is the definition of the all-time measure. So what do we say from here? Because of this, what we have here, because of what we have here, J is covered by all of this. But by the Emborian's theorem, you know, by the Emborian's theorem, it has a finite subcover. What does that mean? That means J can also be covered by some finite number of intervals. Maybe I call it R now. So this is what we have. That's the purpose of this theorem. It has a finite subcover, like you can see here. But let IKR be equal to, you know, we are in R. So open interval is just like this. We can see let IKR be equal to AKR, comma BKR. That is what we have. So we have this. So what is the next thing to do? The next thing to do is that, you know, J is closed interval AB. That means the closed interval AB is covered by union of R starting from 1 to n of IKR. So what is the next thing to do? Now, if A, let's say for example, if A is inside, of course, A and B has to be in one of the intervals, right? So if A is inside, let's say IKJ, because let's say this is the closed interval AB. If this is the closed interval AB, then you have different covers that is covering its finite ones. And of course, they have to overlap. They have to overlap, because if they don't overlap, then it won't fully cover A and B. So they have to overlap at some point. That will be very important in this proof. So we have this. So A will be in one of them. I mean, A will have to be in one of them. They can be much, but they are finite. So A will be in one of them. So let's say A is inside IKJ. That is AKJ is strictly less than A, less than BKJ. That is what we have here. So what happened to it? Will soon be done. So if A is less than, if AKJ is less than A, less than BKJ, the next question you need to ask is B also in the same interval? If B is also in the same interval, if B is also in the same interval, it means that it will be less than BKJ. So BKJ, let me call this J1 so that I don't have to keep repeating or giving different index. BJ1. So this is J1. That means that the closed interval AB is fully contained in just the open interval AJ1BJ1. And what does that mean? What does that mean? It means that BJ, the length BJ1 minus AJ1 will actually be bigger than B minus A. Greater than or equal to. Will actually be bigger than B minus A. And this, obviously, it will be bigger than everything, the whole length of the interval we have been talking about from the definition, right, of the outer measure, and this is what you will have. So to round this up, you just take the infimum of both sides. Since this is not depending on any of the k, by the time you take the infimum of both sides, then you have m star of j to be greater than or equal to b minus a. That is what you will have. But then, if that is not the case, what do I mean? If B is greater than BJI, then that means, with what I've showed you here, then that means it will have to be in one of the intervals. It can be in the next one, it can be in the third one. You will always find it in one of them. But let's assume it's in the next interval, for example. So if B is less than BJ2, what do we do in this case? What happens is that it means that the closed interval AB is fully covered by AJ1, BJ1 union AJ2, BJ2. And what does that mean? B minus A must be less than BJ1 minus AJ1 plus BJ2 minus AJ2. This is possible by monotonicity instead. By monotonicity of the outer measure, you have this. Then, if you rearrange this, say this is BJ1 plus BJ2 minus AJ1 minus AJ2, you will see that eventually all of this value here is greater than B minus A. Actually, that is why I have to rearrange it this way. It's greater than B minus A. And what does that mean? It means that by the time you bring this summation again, okay, starting from 1 to infinity of the length of ik, this will be greater than all of this here, BJ1, this should be BJ2, this will be BJ1, BJ2 plus BJ1 minus AJ2 minus AJ1. And this is obviously greater than or equal to B minus A. And whichever way will be done by that. But if that's not the case, if it's not on the second one, we can keep repeating this process until we get to where the second, until we get to where B is. So basically to round off this question, if B is also greater than BJ2, then we repeat this process. For some n which is less than or equal to n, for some n less or equal to n times, and by so doing, the b will now be like for some n less or equal to n. So when we get to this n, b will obviously be there. B just have to be there. So to round it off, we now have closed interval AB to be fully contained in AJ1, BJ1, then it goes till you get to AJN, BJN. And eventually, you will see that the summation of as k star from 1 to infinity of the length of ik will be greater than the sum here. That is starting from BJN. Then you rearrange it the way I have rearranged it the other time, BJ N minus 1 minus A J J N. Then you keep going till you get to minus A J 1. And then you have greater than or equal to B minus A. So eventually you take the infimum of both sides again. By the time you take the infimum, then you have the outer measure of J to be greater than or equal to B minus A. Don't forget, we have proved that the outer measure is less than B minus A. Now, we have the outer measure to be greater than B minus A. Therefore, they are equal. M star J is equal to B minus A. That is what you have. And what does that mean? Equal to the length of AB, and that will be all.